Anime starts with a flashback, at the time of Fitoa catastrophe where Sylphie transported to a spot several thousand feet above the gardens of the Royal Palace of Azura, Ariel having breakfast while her two personal knights, Luke Noto's Grey Rat and Derek Redbat stayed on guard, with higher expectations from Ariel, Derek expected her to inherit the throne. However, she preferred to stay away from all the politics of the Azura Kingdom and loved enjoying her time alone doing as she pleased. Suddenly a monstrous boar rushed toward Ariel and killed Derek with one swoop. Using her air magic, Sylphie inadvertently crushed the boar's head, which also helped her land safely with minimal injuries. After waking up from unconsciousness, Sylphie had an audience with the princess who told her she'd be imprisoned for trespassing. However, as she saved her life, princess wanted to return the favor by finding her family. Ariel altered Sylphie's appearance to conceal her identity and named her Fitz. After Luke listed her itinerary, Ariel greeted all the guests with her knights at the royal banquet hall. Upon meeting Ariel, Pilemon asked her not to forget about their appointment, where he'd discuss her safety matters. Intruding on their conversation, Graben greeted Ariel and tried to mock Pilemon, blaming him in a roundabout way for stealing the best portion of the cake every year. Ariel took to the stage to give a harmonious performance with her beautiful vocal skills that entranced everyone. Elsewhere, Fitz, who was left stranded amidst a huge crowd, was panicking. Later the next day, Ariel met Pilemon as promised, and they both discussed the security concerns. After Pilemon left, concerned for her family and friends, Fitz asked Ariel if there was any news. As everyone from the Buena village was scattered around the world, it was hard for Ariel to track Fitz's close ones due to limited authority. To comfort Fitz, Ariel asked her to share a bed with her to help her get over her nightmares. While discussing Ariel's influence overshadowing his popularity in the Azura Kingdom, Grabble seconded his advisor Darius' plan for orchestrating a coup. With Grabble being fixated on inheriting the throne, he wanted Ariel out of the picture. After Fitz showed up in her room, Ariel started teasing her by pretending to have a romantic interest in her. Ariel revealed that she was also being haunted by her nightmares, where all she could see was Derek being killed by the boar on a loop. Ariel promised Fitz that she would be there for her at every step. With Fitz by her side, the princess was relieved. Later at night, Ariel was attacked by a mysterious assassin. However, Fitz saved her by defeating the killer using her air magic. Despite being grazed by the assassin's poisonous blade, Fitz was able to negate its effect due to her proficiency in healing magic. Ariel knew that she had no option other than to leave the kingdom. However, she proclaimed that she would return to inherit the throne of Azura as their rightful queen after forging ties with powerful foreign dignitaries. Ariel wanted to relieve Fitz from her duties, however Fitz declined the offer and swore to be by her side. Together with Fitz and Luke, Ariel set out on her new quest. Back to the present time, Rudy is heading to the Northlands in a caravan like a stowaway traveler. Suzanne, another adventurer in the same convoy concerned for Rudius, tried to engage in a conversation with him, but he declined even to answer her questions, which utterly incensed her accomplice Sarah. Rudius revealed that he was traveling to the Northlands to look for his mother and his people after the teleport incident happened in the Fitoa region. To help him get acquainted with how things go in the Northlands, Suzanne eventually explained to Rudius the dynamics of the three great magical nations. After reaching the location, Rudius took some rest at a local inn. While holding on to the lock of Eris' hair, Rudius realized the journey he began was not to lament over his broken relationship but to find his mother. He eventually registered with the nearby guild to officially disband his party. He decided to take on the highest paying job, disregarding the consequences of the difficulty, because he needed money to aid his quest to get back together with his loved one. However, intruding on his decision, Suzanne offered help and invited him to join her crew. Suzanne introduced Rudius to her team, revealing that she and her crew desperately needed a new recruit to take on missions efficiently. Later in the morning, as decided, they met at the North Gate to set off for their mission. En route to the location, each member introduced themselves to Rudius and even revealed their specialty and position within the party. While introducing herself, Sarah warned Rudius that if he botched the job and caused one of her party members to lose their lives, she would kill him. Rudius was amazed by how Sarah's persona starkly resembled Eris. While camping near the nest of Luster Grizzlies, Rudius strategized with the counter arrow to confirm his positioning. Using his Exa Flame incantation, Timothy attacked the nest of Luster Grizzlies multiple times in a row. As the beasts were harder to put down, Ridius and Counter Arrow eventually got surrounded by a horde of grizzlies who covered themselves with mud to negate the effects of fire-based attacks. Despite the horror of getting ripped apart into shreds by the approaching beasts, Ridius gave up and accepted his fate. However, the members of Counter Arrow held their ground and fought the creatures with all their strength. While a horde of grizzlies began to move closer to Sarah and Suzanne, who were completely fatigued, Ridius defended them using his devastating fire magic attack and defeated the creatures at once. Later, the crew harvested the hides from Luster grizzlies. Ridius, who was afraid to get along in the beginning, finally shook hands with Suzanne and thanked her for her and her team's help. While submitting the collected resources to the guild, Ridius and his team didn't receive the welcome and applause of the locals. Instead, they were despised for being outsiders. However, Timothy lightened everyone's mood by offering them free rounds to bring attention to the identities of Counter Arrow and Ridius Greyrat. Later at night, alone in his room, Ridius despised himself for giving up so easily. After recalling his journey, he let go of the remnants of the memories holding him back. Ridius took a stand that he would move forward and work hard. Next morning, Ridius having his morning run, while heading back toward the inn, he took a brief pause to seek feedback from his legs, fondly referred to as Tyndalos and Baskerville, regarding his form. After finally heading back to his apartment, Ridius continued his workout with a few push-ups while encouraging both his arms, Hulk and Hercules. Later, he headed to the guild where another party was just leaving to clear a snow drake infestation out of Ibran Cave. Over the months, Ridius garnered a lot of appreciation for his hard work, and he earned the nickname Quagmire by the locals. After accepting to take part in a mission, Ridius headed to the Galgal ruins alongside the Counter Arrow to collect the scales of snow drakes, which was an easier mission according to him. The stone carvings inside the ruins reminded him of the demon god Kishirika. Suddenly, the crew was surrounded by hordes of snow drakes, but they eventually defended against the monstrous creatures with effective teamwork. Surprisingly, an unknown guy arrived at the location and defeated the remaining creatures in a whiplash. Infuriated by another party conducting business where they initially got sanction from the guild, caused the leader of the party Soldat punched Timothy. However, he quickly realized that it was merely a misunderstanding, as Counter Arrow's job was solely to collect the scales of snow drakes rather than eradicate the infestation. Later at the local inn, the Counter Arrow members celebrated the accomplishments of their new mission. Suzanne teased Sarah for rushing to save the helpless Ridius, who got surrounded by the creatures. Upon sighting Timothy, Heckler appeared on the scene to counsel him against being kind to people like him and tried to encourage him to take a stand for himself. Later, Soldat berated Ridius for carrying a fake smile instead of dealing with what made him suffer. Soldat encountered Ridius once again and pitted him for taking low-level missions once again. Through Suzanne, Ridius learned that Mimir and Sarah had gone missing and probably could have been dead. Upon learning about their last known location, the west part of the Trier Forest, Ridius headed out all on his own amidst the blinding snow blizzard. After altering the weather around his vicinity, Ridius entered the Trier Forest, where he encountered the snow buffaloes and eliminated them all. Ridius collected Mimir's remains and burned his body along with the corpses of creatures. Suddenly, he was attacked by a sentient tree, but luckily got saved by his wand. After saving Sarah, who was captured by the tree, Ridius took her to a nearby cave and healed her wounds. Before they left the cave to head back to the town, Sarah thanked Ridius for coming to her rescue. Suzanne was relieved after reuniting with Sarah, but was upset over Ridius for risking his life. Surprisingly, Sarah defended Ridius by not allowing Suzanne to be hard on him. Ridius has been working with the Counter Arrow on a consistent basis recently. His reputation has really grown and a lot of people have started talking about him. Interestingly, he has also gotten really closer to Sarah. Since her blade is getting chipped, she asks Ridius to go with her shopping the following day. But soon it becomes to dawn on him that she actually wants to ask him out on a date. The two continue to drink together quite late into the night, and later Sarah asks him if she can come to his room. Ridius understands what she means and feels quite nervous. In the room, the two start making out and everything appears to be going well until Ridius realizes that he can't get an erection for some reason. Sarah is visibly upset when she later leaves the room and also tells him that she is not really into him. Ridius is understandably upset by this incident and goes to the bar to have some drinks. That's when Soldant says something that he ends up beating him up. The two eventually reconcile and Soldant learns what happened between him and Sarah. He feels that he needs professional help and takes him to the nearby brothel, hoping that it will fix his problem. Since the high-class brothel does not really help Ridius much, Soldant and he walk out of it disappointed. Soldant shares his experiences at the labyrinth and recalls how things would often get tougher the deeper he went. Every labyrinth requires a different strategy since the monster inside poses a different level of threat. So in such a time, running and blinding is often more problematic than most people realize. Soldant connects those experiences to the present scenario and tells Ridius to give himself time and get used to certain things before taking the next big step. Although he feels that Sarah was prepared to establish a sexual relationship with Ridius, he also notices that his friend was probably not prepared emotionally and had also rushed things. Ridius points out that he did everything just out of obligation and does not even like him, but Soldant feels that he is not right in his assessment. He advises his friend to pay him a visit and talk things out with her. For some reason, Ridius then tells Soldant that he does not want a woman like Sarah and goes on to say that she is built like a kid. Ridius does not stop there and also compares her body with Elise. His comments are obviously too harsh, and unfortunately for him, he does not realize how loud he is talking. All of a sudden, Soldant freezes as he sees someone behind Ridius. Soon Ridius realizes that Sarah heard everything that he had to say, and she immediately slaps him as hard as she can. He cannot really say much to stop her and falls to his knees realizing what he has done. Soldant slaps him on the head and asks him to run after her. Since he feels sorry for his friend, Soldant tells Ridius about a labyrinth in the Dutsi of Nerys and asks him to tag along for his next adventure. Ridius spends the next 2 years adventuring with Soldat's party, and is even able to take out a red dragon single-handedly. Shortly after, Alinalis finally catches up to Ridius and informs him that his mother Zenith is in the labyrinth city of Rapa in the Bigaret continent, and Paul and Roxy had already set off to the labyrinth city to find Zenith. In the meantime, Ridius decides to stay in the Northlands until winter passes before traveling to Rapa himself, and he quickly finds out about Alinalai's promiscuity, that she has to sleep with men every day because of her curse. Sometime later, Ridius receives a letter from the Rinoa University of Magic inviting him to attend as a special student. Due to his recent exploits, he doesn't jump at the chance at first, even though Alinalai assures him he can reunite with his family afterwards. That night, Ridius encounters the human god in his dreams again, with the human god advising him to enroll at the university and investigate the teleportation disaster there, promising that doing so will cure his erectile dysfunction. That settles it for Rudy. Even before he wakes to find Alinalis sleeping in his bed, Ridius is persuaded to accept the university's invitation and journeys to Rinoa with Alinalis. Meanwhile, it is shown that Slifey and Ariel are also students at the university. As he reaches the university, he's thrown into a mock trial with one of the school's other silent incanting special student known as Silent Fitz. Ridius doesn't recognize her because of different appearance and mistakes her for a man. When Rudy sees Fitz's attack with her right eye before it happens, he uses disturbed magic to negate it and sends her to the floor. When he realizes she may have caused Fitz to lose face, he loudly proclaims she let him win because he's new. When he promises Fitz he'll make it up to her later, as Sylphie blushes, after attending a speech by Ariel, who is the student council president, Ridius attends his homeroom class. There he reunites with Zenoba, whom he met and befriended while in Chiron and who calls Ridius master, as well as meets his fellow classmates like Guy's daughter Linnea Didoldia, Beast Girl Persina, and self-proclaimed magical genius Cliff Grimoire, who tells him he knows Ridius because of Eris. He also learns Fitz is part of his class but rarely attends. While eating lunch with Zenoba, Rudy is approached by Luke and his two girlfriends, who reveals he is also a Grey Rat and Ridius' cousin. Later, while Ridius is on his way back to his dorm, Fitz accidentally drops Ariel's panties from a window, which Ridius catches, and is immediately called out as a panty thief and surrounded by angry women, many of them brandishing brooms and led by a gargantuan gorilla demi-human girl. The gorilla girl is about to bring him in when Fitz stops her, saying he dropped the princess laundry out the window while hanging it out to dry. Even after Fitz vouches for Rudy, the gorilla girl still wants to take him in for walking on a girl's only pathway, even though he doesn't know all the dorm rules yet. Fitz finally has to raise his wand and insist she unhand him, unless she and all the other girls want to end up in the infirmary. The gorilla girl named Goliath stands down, and she and the other girls leave Rudy alone. Fitz heals Rudy, who apologizes and thanks him for having his back, and Fitz decides to tease Rudius by not telling him her true identity. Rudius begins to get used to school life in the university, where he studies magic he lacks experience in as well as researches the cause of the teleportation disaster. Fitz tells Rudius she also lost someone in the teleportation disaster, but like him she now knows that person is alive. Sylphie remains mum on her true identity to Rudy. Meanwhile, Rudy notes his heart starts beating faster whenever Fitz smiles or laughs, even though he's convinced she is a man. Prince Zenobit desperately wants Rudy to teach him how to create figures. Rudy said he would teach him, and so he tries to do so. But Zenobia proves hopeless both at forging figures the magical way and by carving clay with a knife. When he mentions his problem to Fitz, she suggests they find a particularly dexterous slave who can magically carve them for the prince. Fitz also manages to get Rudy to invite him, which makes her very happy. Going to the market to browse fur and buy slaves is natural in this world. They come across the very kind of slave who is perfectly suited for being taught how to make figures with magic, a young dwarf girl. Dwarves are great with their hands, and the earlier you teach someone magic the more mana they end up with when they're grown. Rudius recognizes the girl's eyes of his past self, someone for whom despair seems to have taken over. He quietly asks her if she wants to die and even considers putting her out of her misery. When the girl manages to utter that she doesn't want to die, that's enough for Rudy. They buy her, and immediately set to work feeding and training her. As she didn't has any name, they named her Juliet. Afterwards, Rudius begins tutoring Julie to teach her magic and general skills while she acts as Zenobia's servant. As Sylphie gets used to school life with Rudius back in her life, she begins to realize that she may have romantic feelings for him. 1 month after Zenobia's purchase of Julie, Rudius has been able to teach her basic magic as well as how to cast without incantations. When Rudy insists on seeing the Roxy figurine he made for Zenobia, and learns it was been smashed to pieces, Zenobia is forced to admit that in his first year, he lost a duel to Linnea and Persina, who destroyed the sculpture. Angered, Rudius wastes no time confronting Linnea and Persina and challenging them to a fight. When Linnea doesn't rise to his initial provocations, Rudy makes fun of her, saying "meow" to end her sentences, which sets her off like a bomb. While she's quick and vicious, Linnea is no match for Rudy, and he ends up knocking out and bagging both beast girls. When Linnea and Persina come to, they're tied up and gagged in Rudy's dorm. They assume he intends to do naughty things, but he shows them what they did to his sculpture and why it's a crime against his faith. After asking Fitz for advice on how to get retribution without continuing a cycle of revenge, Rudius and Fitz return to find the two have wet themselves, complain about being hungry, and have started to call him boss. Rudius, inexperienced in keeping people captive, brought them to heal. After the girls are cleaned up, Fitz's solution to properly punish them is to draw on their faces and warn them that a simple incantation will make the marks permanent tattoos. The Doldia girls leave in peace, still calling Rudius boss, and impressed that his master was Rinia's Aunt Ghislaine. Sylphie uses this opportunity to spend a little more time alone with Rudius in his dorm. Even lying down on his bed, Rudius thinks about what would happen if he reached over and removed the mask over Fitz's eyes, and just then Fitz asks if he wants to see his whole face. Sylphie almost takes the shades off, but stops short, saying she's under orders from the princess. They bid each other goodnight. Rudy finds himself on better terms with Rinia and Persina now that they consider him their alpha, but he has to apologize for the three of them when Cliff Grimoire complains about the noise they make goofing off in class. Later, Rudy catches Cliff being beaten up by six fellow students, who immediately flee when Quagmire shows up. Cliff's deal is that he's got the hots for Elinalize, and he got into the fight by protecting her honor. Rudy happens to know that Elinalize is indeed guilty of all of the rumors about her sleeping around. Cliff asks Rudius to introduce him to Elinalize, as he has developed crush on her. Rudy confers with Fitz on this, and it actually gives Sylphie an opportunity to say that she likes someone. Even though she still won't come out and tell him who, she believes it's fine to introduce them, and everything that happens from then on isn't Rudy's problem. Rudy follows Fitz's advice, but when he introduces Elinalize to Cliff, she snatches Rudy up for a quick sidebar. If she believes her curse won't allow her to be monogamous, then Rudy tells her she should reject Cliff. But the next day he finds that Cliff and Elinalize have become a couple, with Cliff promising to find a way to lift the curse. Later, the beast men of the school begin challenging Rudeus for the right to marry Linnea and Persina, having been misled by the beast girls that he is their pack leader. However, the beast men are all defeated by the demon king Badagati, the fiancé of Kishirika, who challenges Rudeus to a duel after hearing of Kishirika's praise of him. Fitz brings Rudy his staff, and Rudy asks if Badagati will spare his life if he wins. Badagati also seems to know of the man god, but doesn't know anything about him. The demon king agrees to accept defeat if Rudy can wound him with a single blow. Rudy conjures the sharpest, fastest spinning drill bit his mana can create, and attacks him. When the smoke clears, Badagati is a fraction of the size he was and missing a couple of arms. He heals himself but accepts defeat. Badagati doesn't leave without planting his own blow on Rudy, resulting in a comically swollen cheek that Fitz easily heals before leaving Rudy to rest. The next day in class, Rinia and Persina are grateful, but who should arrive in class as a new transfer student but Badagati and his body laugh. Flitz wants to reveal her true identity to Rudeus but fears he might have forgotten her. She gets encouraged by Ariel's approval. Meanwhile, Rudeus continues to study teleportation and sees many similarities to summoning magic. Fitz suggests he consult with a summoning specialist, Silent Seven Star, but Rudeus is shocked to discover it is Nanahoshi, and faints after reliving the trauma of his death at Orsted's hands. Fitz revives Rudeus, and Nanahoshi shows Rudeus two Japanese names, Shinohara Akito and Kuroki Satoshi, and asks if either of those names belong to him. Rudeus doesn't recognize the names and comes to the realization that Nanahoshi is a person from his own world. Nanahoshi removes her mask and formally introduces herself as Nanahoshi Shizuka, and Rudeus notes she resembles the high school girl he died attempting to save. However, Nanahoshi wants to find a way back to their world while Rudeus wants to stay. She explains that unlike Rudeus, who was reincarnated as a child, she was summoned to the fantasy world as she is now 5 years ago, though she hasn't aged since. Orsted found her and took her under his care, and she has been studying summoning magic ever since. Though she lacks mana capacity and cannot cast magic herself, she makes a deal with Rudeus where he will use his mana to assist her in her experiments in return for her knowledge about teleportation. She further explains that the mass teleportation disaster was possibly a side effect of the spell that summoned her to the fantasy world. On the way back, Fitz is glad to hear Rudeus has no romantic feelings for Nanahoshi. Fitz continues to feel jealous how Rudeus is spending most of his time assisting in Nanahoshi's experiments now. A year has passed since Rudy enrolled at Rinoa. As Sylphie wallows in her cowardice for being unable to tell him who she really is, he continues to carry out his daily routine and interact with Zenoba and others. He even has a meal with his old buddy Soldat, who is briefly in town. Despite being there a year, Rudy is no closer to finding a cure for his impotence, though Nanahoshi Shizuka does at least lend him some literature on teleporting, with all the time he's spending helping Shizuka with her experiments. He realizes he's seen less of Fitz lately. In town, when he spots him seemingly alone with Luke, he says hi, but Fitz avoids him, which wounds Rudy deeply. But when he spots Fitz in the library, he's back to his friendly self. When Rudy says he was worried Fitz hated him, Fitz giggles and tells him there's no way he'd ever hate him, and he realized Fitz couldn't reply him before, maybe because she was on her duty. Considering how much Fitz is on his mind, Rudy can't deny that he's fallen in love with him, and begins to have doubts that Fitz is male. After asking the vice principal about Fitz's gender proves futile, Rudy suspects he's under pressure from higher-ups. Rudy returns to the library, then Fitz suddenly touches him on the shoulder, startling him and causing him to fall backwards. Fitz instinctively reaches out to arrest his fall but ends up on the floor. Feeling Fitz's feminine body, he is able to confirm that she is in fact female. Fitz flees in embarrassment, and Rudeus realizes that for a brief moment he felt an erection. Now knowing Fitz's true sex and that she holds the key to curing his impotence, Rudeus decides to start a relationship with her. When Ariel and Luke learn that Rudy has no intention of revealing her true identity to anyone else, they decide to help Sylphie. When Ariel asks if there are any strong memories she has with Rudy, Sylphie mentions when they bathed together and Rudy undressed her. When asked what kind of relationship she seeks with Rudy, Sylphie doesn't hold back, telling her she's perfectly fine having lots and lots of kids with him. So Ariel and Luke come up with a plan to help jog Rudeus' memory. Later, Fitz invites Rudeus to accompany her to gather a rare flower deep in the forest despite it being the middle of winter. Rudeus agrees and the pair travel into the forest. Fitz then secretly casts a spell to cause it to rain. Rudy suggests they take shelter in a nearby cave. Everything is going off without a hitch for Sylphie. When she sits shivering in the cave by the fire, Rudy offers to avert his gaze so she can change out of her cold, wet clothes. But Sylphie tells him she needs him to undress her. He tells her that he knows she's a woman. She says she knows, but she wants him to undress her anyway. As he start removing her clothes, but as soon her shades removed, he realizes he's looking at Sylphie. She confirms that she is indeed Sylphie, and that she's been waiting along to tell him that. She doesn't hold back in declaring her undying love for Rudy, and demands that he never leave her side again. Rudeus was surprised by how he failed to learn that Fitz was indeed Sylphie. However, he soon realized how much she had matured from a literal crybaby to a more level-headed person and felt relieved to be reunited with her. Rudeus eventually responded to Sylphie's proposal by revealing that he loved her in return. But to his dismay, he cannot make love to her since his impotence still isn't fully cured. As Sylphie understood the crisis Rudeus was going through, she sat by him to comfort him. The two headed back the next day to Rinoa, where Ariel and Luke were frantically waiting to hear everything that had transpired with Sylphie during their trip. Upon learning about Rudeus's illness, Luke agreeing to help Sylphie find a cure for Rudeus' impotence out of sympathy for him. Luke gifts Sylphie a rare and powerful aphrodisiac that should counter Rudeus' impotence, while Ariel provides some advice on how to seduce him. Sylphie meets Rudeus later that night and they both imbibe the aphrodisiac, which helps push them to make love. The next day, Rudeus was about to break down after finding Sylphie gone, similar to how Eris abandoned him. However, much to his surprise, she had simply gone out to meet with Luke and Ariel. Rudeus hugged Sylphie and revealed that his illness was cured. Rudeus then thanks Ariel for her help by pledging his loyalty to her. Ariel asks him what's his next plan to do as he's cured now. Rudeus revealed his plans to head north to look for his family. However, Ariel pointed out that embarking on such a journey would eventually result in saying goodbye to Sylphie. Upon realizing this, Rudeus proclaimed his intention to marry Sylphie. Ariel releases Sylphie from her obligation to disguise herself as Fitz and accepts Rudeus as part of her inner circle, and they both promised each other to cherish the love between them. Sylphie then thanks Ariel and Luke for everything they've done for her. So this is the end of anime. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed it.